I love having a problem that perhaps no one's ever solved before, and bringing together different people with different expertise to try to go forward rather than stagnating. Lucy from Auckland asks, why do we commonly see the sea receding prior to large waves happening with a tsunami? That's a great question, Lucy, and it's a question we often get asked. If you think about a tsunami as being a wave like you might see on a string that you move up and down, or you might see on a calm pond when ripples propagate out from throwing a rock, you know that the wave has crests and troughs. So when you see the water go out first, it means that trough is arriving at the coastline first. Why would this happen? When we make a tsunami from an earthquake, or when a tsunami is made from an earthquake, it's made because you have places on the seafloor that either rise, creating a big column of water that then smashes down and spreads out, or drops, creating a trough in the water that then spreads out and goes out like a propagating tsunami or moving tsunami. A lot of tsunamis are caused by both of these motions, where you get uplift and subsidence from the same earthquake. Some are caused purely from uplift, some are caused purely from subsidence. So you can imagine if the part of the wave that hits you first is caused by that downdropping portion, you'll get a receding of the ocean. Great question, Lucy. I hope that answers your question, and I hope now you understand that sometimes we get a wave rise, a wave drop before the big tsunami waves come on. But what's absolutely crucial is that anyone, if they do see some sort of abnormal activity in the ocean like this, if you see the water recede for a long way out, you need to treat that as a possible tsunami coming in, and you need to evacuate accordingly. Thank you very much.
So this question from Marion in Palmerston North. Why do we always worry about tsunamis when they only cause really small waves in New Zealand? This is a really good question. So first of all, tsunamis come in a range of sizes from centimetres to many metres. And like a lot of hazards, we see the small events much more frequently than we see the very large events. But you're right, in most of our lifetimes, we've only seen quite small waves from tsunamis in New Zealand. But our historical record and our geological record tell us that New Zealand is exposed and vulnerable to much larger tsunamis, and they could happen again in the future. So in our written period of history, we've had about 50 tsunamis that have impacted the shores of Aotearoa. Most of them have been quite small, but one interesting one is the 1947 earthquake up near Gisborne. This was a magnitude 7.2 earthquake. It triggered a tsunami that was up to 13 metres high in some places along the coastline north and south of Gisborne. At the time, it was a very sparsely populated coastline, so there were no fatalities, but if the same event happened today, it would probably have a much greater impact because the coastline has a lot more development on it. The geological record is really interesting too. So we can use, when large tsunamis occur, they pick up marine sediment like rock and sand and shells and deposit it inland. We can use these sediments to date the timing and size of past earthquakes. And these sediments are present at many places around the New Zealand coastline. And they tell us that in the past, we've had tsunamis that have been many metres high and have gone hundreds of metres to kilometres inland. All right, I hope that helps answer your question, Marion.
I go out to sea a lot on ships to study things like earthquakes and tsunami. Working together with a big team of people, just super, super fun. I had a question from Bill in Wellington, and he's asking, how can a tsunami be so huge? He also says, I think I find it difficult to understand how the sheer volume of water that is displaced from the original area can be such a large amount and how far inland it seems to be able to go. So tsunami are basically generated large due to a sort of a sudden displacement of the seafloor, sudden displacement of the seabed. Most commonly this happens in earthquakes. That's where most of our tsunami are generated, but this can also happen when we have submarine landslides and volcanic activity. Those can also displace large portions of the seabed and generate tsunami. I'll focus a little bit on earthquakes. In earthquakes, you can have hundreds of kilometers long area, maybe even up to 1,000 kilometer long area displaced. And so in the really big earthquakes, you might be getting up to maybe 100 cubic kilometers of water of water column that's being displaced. And out in the deep ocean, where many of these tsunamis are generated, you know, in deep water, you know, the waves might be very small and maybe less than a foot, but the wavelength of the wave can actually be very wide, like more like 100 kilometers or so. So if you're out in a boat in the ocean, you wouldn't even know this wave probably was passing underneath you. However, things really start to get real when we get closer to the coastline and you get into shallow water. And so as that wave comes into the shallower water, everything kind of scrunches up together and piles up, and you get a much, much higher wave that then ends up, you know, inundating your coastline. And, you know, as many people have seen photos and videos of this type of thing happening. So what really controls how far inland a tsunami goes, it's going to be very dependent on the shape of the seabed beneath the ocean near the coastline. That's going to really influence how that tsunami wave builds up and comes in. Also the shape of the coastline and also the topography. So if you have a long, flat land area going inland from the coast, then your water can potentially travel further inland, as opposed to where if you have a very steep coastline, it's not, you know, going to be able to travel as far inland. So I hope that answers your question. Thanks for asking such a good question.
Yeah, Mojo from Wellington asking an interesting question. Does the Wellington Harbour protect the city from a tsunami? The answer is rather complex, can be both yes and no. It really depends on how a tsunami will impact the city and where a tsunami will come from. The Wellington city can be impacted by a tsunami from different sources, including those outside the harbor and also those inside the harbor. If a tsunami is coming from outside the harbor, for example, South America across the Pacific Ocean, the narrow harbor entrance will be able to limit the amount of tsunami energy entering the harbor, then the tsunami impact will be less severe inside the harbor than the outside. But in a large high-ground event, the tsunami may also find its way through the low-lying southern harbors, such as Lao Bay or Kilbirnie. If a tsunami is generated from inside the harbor, such as Wellington Fault, then the narrow harbor entrance channel limits the amount of energy escaping. Additionally, the particular shape of the Wellington Harbor means its natural water oscillation patterns may likely be mobilized by either a ground motion or the incoming tsunami waves. This is kind of like we're holding a bowl of water. We shake the bowl, the water will oscillate and may get higher and higher until it spills. It may also cause a much longer duration of tsunami impact inside the harbor. Hopefully, this answers your question.
Okay, so the question is, if there was a big earthquake and it collapsed dams in the South Waikato area, would a tsunami go down the Waikato River and wipe out Hamilton? Thanks for this question. So first of all, dams in New Zealand are designed for certain seismic safety standards. So they are engineered to withstand certain amounts of ground shaking. Now the good news is that the South Waikato area is a relatively low seismicity area of New Zealand. So there are very few active faults in that area, and the likelihood of very high intensity shaking is quite low. And the other thing is that about every 10 years or so, this information on seismic hazard is reviewed and incorporated into dam safety assessments. So they're continually using new knowledge about seismic safety to monitor those dams. I guess in the very unlikely circumstance that a dam did collapse in the South Waikato area, the lake levels and the river levels are very well monitored. So you would be able to see these changes quite quickly and hopefully have time to evacuate downstream if there was a large pulse of water coming down. The other thing I wanted to mention was that if you are near one of these large reservoirs or lakes during a big earthquake, a long or strong earthquake, it's still a good idea to just evacuate that area and get away from the water anyway. This is because large earthquakes can trigger seiches, which slosh the water back and forth, sometimes for hours after an earthquake. And large earthquakes can also trigger landslides into the lake, and a landslide going suddenly into a lake can trigger a tsunami there as well. All right, hope that helps.